Alrighty, I think we're going to go ahead and get started because this is a presentation that has a very specific ending. Not only because that's the way I designed it, but because they'll cut me off at that point because lunch is right after this. So I want to make sure that I actually get through the presentation for all of you who have joined me today. My name is James A. Owen, for those of you who don't know me. I'm an author, illustrator, I've been a publisher. I have been both indie and traditional, and I am a little bit unique in the fact that I also illustrate my own books. I illustrate the covers. In some of the novels, I've illustrated the chapters because I came from a culture in comic books where I wrote and illustrated my own comics. So when I transitioned to novels, that felt like a natural transition to me. And the book that I'm best known for is called Here There Be Dragons. And I'm going to be talking about this one a few times today. Drawing Out the Dragons, as I said in the description and also in the post I did this morning, this isn't a talk about craft, though there's going to be a drawing at the end. Isn't trying to teach you how to do anything with regards to your work specifically. What this talk is about is teaching you to overcome obstacles which are gonna arise for all of us and get around them so that you can do the thing that you love. And that's it. And none of us walks the same path, but we walk similar paths because we have similar goals. And those of us that have walked the paths ahead of you are better equipped to help warn you and guide you through those obstacles that you're going to encounter. Now, when I started, Here There Be Dragons was published by Simon & Schuster, and they sent me out on a book tour. And I had done appearances, I'd done signings, done a lot in comics, hadn't done a traditional book tour, and I realized when I was standing in front of 800 kids at a middle school with the teachers and the sponsoring booksellers, they were expecting me to do a book talk and a sales pitch. And I thought, if I have the attention of 800 kids for an hour, I want to spend that time talking about things that are more important than just selling books. Because they're going to buy the books, or the librarian's going to get the books, and they have teachers that can talk about the books. But I had that short amount of time to express something important and hopefully meaningful to them. And that's when I started what has become the Drawing Out the Dragons talk. And the things that I wanted to express, I'm probably going to repeat them once or twice here. A few very important principles that some of the schools started writing down. So I'd come back for later book tours and the kids would be mouthing these phrases along with me. If you really want to do something, no one can stop you. But if you really don't want to do something, no one can help you. You have to make that brave choice to decide to do the thing that you believe in. You also have to live deliberately to decide, are you the kind of person who makes things happen or the kind of person things happen to? Because that is two different kinds of people. You have to decide to make things happen, to choose, to actively do things and let other things swirl around your wake. One of the most important points that I hope to get across to you today is also this. Never sacrifice what you want the most for what you want the most in that moment. Because in that moment, what you want the most might seem like the most important thing. But decide. You have to choose. Think, if you're making that choice, how will you feel 1 second later? And if there's an ounce of hesitation, then you know it's not the thing that you want the most. But also, you know, Craig has talked about how the rising tide lifts all boats, and we collectively are the rising tide. And that is one of the lessons that is most important to me, that I think is important to share with each of you, is that the best thing one human being can say to another is, I will not let you fall. I believe in you, and I will not let you fall. Now, when I was a kid, I had some ambitions to do this for a living. People have asked me, well, you've been doing this a long time. How old were you when you decided on this as your career? And I told them, I can tell you exactly how old I was. I was 6 years old. Because every so often, I'll be searching around on eBay for first editions or some of the comic books that I'd done. And one day I was doing that, and I saw a listing that said James Owen's first published work. And I thought, okay, that's the comic I did in high school. So I clicked on it. That's not what popped up. What popped up was a little cartoon book, Goldilocks and the Three Bears plus Santa Claus by Jamie Owen, age 6. So I was already a fan and mixing mythologies, clearly, and apparently I thought my age was a selling point. I had asked my mother for one of those little ray guns that you buy at the toy store, that you pull the trigger and it makes sparks, and she told me I needed to earn my own money, and she thought I was going to rake the neighbor's yard or sell chicken eggs. I made these little picture books, and I put them in my wagon, wheeled them around the block because I wasn't allowed to cross the street, and I sold them to the neighbors for 15 cents apiece. One of my childhood friends cleaned out his mother's house and found this little booklet, and he put it on eBay. And I thought, I would really love to have that, so I put a bid on it. Instantly got back this beep, you've been outbid. Okay, well, 10 bucks. Beep, you've been outbid. All right, 20 bucks. Beep, you've been outbid. And I started looking at this more closely and realized there were 4 dozen people watching this auction. And several of them had put in bids that were outbidding me. I kept bidding higher and higher, and at one point, there were 3 other bidders who bid over $50, and I thought, you people are out of your cotton-picking minds. So finally, I checked my bank account, and I bid everything I had in the bank at that moment, $72, and sat there and watched the timer count down, and I thought, yeah, who's going to pay that? Counted down the last few seconds, beep, you've been outbid, and I lost it. Somebody bid $72.50. So I sent him a message and said, congratulations on winning that auction. I don't know if you know this. This is James Owen you were bidding against. And he goes, James, oh my gosh, it's me, your buddy Alex in the Bay Area. I didn't know what your screen name was. It's like my best collector. The guy has a James Owen gallery in his house. Original art, some prints, a hat I signed in Ohio, all this stuff, and now he has outbid me for this book. And I said, I am really glad to know it was you, because there were those 2 other people who both bid over $50. And he's like, yeah, what were they thinking? And I said, well, now that you've got it, I would really love to own that book, if you wouldn't mind selling it to me. And he says, James, I would love to sell it to you, but I have a really complete James Owen collection now. So how about I send you a scan of it? And I thought through this and thought, okay, this guy just paid $72.50 for a 15-page, stapled-together, drawn-in crayon cartoon book about Goldilocks, the Three Bears, and Santa Claus that was written and drawn by a first grader. He deserves to own that book. But that's when I realized it was not that that book was so awesome that all these people were watching that auction and bidding on it. It was all of the choices I'd made since about the work I did in comics and books and film and other entertainment that collectively made other things I've done more valuable to people. And that's because here's a very important principle. All of your choices are cumulative. And the sooner you start making better choices about the things you want to do, the more quickly your life will improve and you will be closer to your goals. Now, this is not to say that all choices are going to be easy. In fact, most of the things that result in some of our best paths forward come about because of choices that are forced on us. When I was 11 years old, I got sick with what at the time they decided was a rare blood disorder. I got so sick that I was allergic to everything, and I had to learn how to give myself injections and carry a syringe and a bottle of epinephrine, because if I had an allergy attack, I would have about 90 seconds before my throat would swell closed. It got so bad, I started having migraines and other organ shutdowns and terrible pain, and I ended up spending most of 5th grade in Good Samaritan Hospital in Phoenix. And it was so bad, I wasn't allowed to go anywhere. And at one point, I actually overheard my mother talking to the doctors. And they said, he is so sick, and we have no idea how to fix him. Now, they put me in this room that had 6 beds. And I had the bed that was closest to the window. And the first week that I was there, the kid in the bed closest to the door died. The second week I was there, the kid in bed number 2 died. And about a month after that, the kid in bed number 3 died. And the rest of us got together and had a little meeting in the bathroom, said, we've figured out what's going on here. They've got us in here in order. And if you think that scared me, you should have seen the kid in bed number 4. But that's when we realized we are the ones that are so sick. They don't know how. They don't know how to fix us. And that's a pretty terrifying thing to realize when you're 11 years old. Now, one bright spot that I had was I was allowed to go to the gift shop. And at the gift shop, they had comic books. And I love comic books. Superman, Batman, X-Men, Teen Titans, all of them. Have a particular love for Superman. I got that tattoo because the embroidered patch I used to carry around, I kept losing it in the wash, so I can't lose this one. And I got this in part because of something that came in one day with those comic books. It was a little paperback called Superman, Last Son of Krypton. And it had an interesting little story in it. In the course of this story, Superman gets poisoned by an enemy from another galaxy. And he gets sick in exactly the same way that I was sick. And that was interesting to me, because I could relate to what I was reading. And then a few things happened all at the same time. One of the things that happened was I got a doctor who had just gotten a grant for something she called adjunct therapy. Nowadays, we call it creative visualization. But she believed that we could have more of a control of our body systems than we understood. I'd like all of you to do something for me, please. Should be very simple, I hope. I'd like you to just inhale and exhale. All right. We are all breathing, and we aren't always conscious of it. It is simply taking place. But when someone asks you to take hold of that particular function, you're able to do it. This doctor believed you could do that with every system in your body down to a cellular level. And there was nothing to lose to try her therapy with her. So we would sit for an hour in the morning and an hour in the afternoon, eyes closed, visualizing the Justice League, shrinking down to a microscopic level, going into my bloodstream, destroying the bad blood cells and building up good new blood cells. At the same time this was taking place, I had a grandfather who had been in Mesa Lutheran Hospital having had a heart attack. And in the religious tradition that I was raised in, we had something called a father's blessing. And my grandfather, he and my grandmother helped my mother raise me, he insisted that this was something I needed to have. And they said I was too sick and he was too sick and it wasn't possible. It wasn't possible to get us both out of the hospital. But I was getting sicker. And the thing that I held on to was this book and a couple of these little Superman digests that I had. And one of the things that happened in that story about Superman, when he got these fever dreams, he dreamed he saw his father from Krypton, Jor-El, who said, son, maybe you're sick and maybe you're dying. I don't know. But I think it's going to be your choice, because this is not your destiny. Your destiny is to go out and change the lives of millions of people throughout the galaxy. And he said, it's your choice whether to live or die. And if you choose to live, that doesn't mean an end to suffering and pain. The only difference that's going to make is the betterment of the lives of millions of people. So you get to decide what your destiny is. They managed to get a day pass for my grandfather and me, so we were able to meet at my grandparents' house so he could do this very special thing for me. And in the course of this father's blessing, not knowing what I'd been reading, He said, I want you to know something. No one knows how to make you better. But he says, I don't think this is the end for you, because that's not your destiny. Your destiny is to take your gifts and to change the lives of millions of people for the better. And I think you get to decide. And it doesn't mean an end to pain or suffering. But in those moments when you feel you are not strong enough to do the things you need to do, you reach out, and your grandmother and I will catch you, because we believe in you, and we will never let you fall. Not too long ago, I found an old Peter Pan book that was my Christmas present when I was going into second grade. And in it, I had tucked a letter from my grandfather that he wrote to me after he had done this thing when I was in the hospital, reasserting these. He wanted me to have it in writing. And 2 weeks after that letter was sent to me is when he died. Somehow he knew that was a message I needed to have. Now, something changed, and I was able to get better, and the doctors couldn't explain why. Somehow it was some combination of all of these things, but for whatever reason, I got better enough that I was able to leave the hospital. And it didn't mean an end to suffering. I've had health issues my entire life, but it meant that I had a chance to go out and do something better. And I was young, and I was ambitious, and I had decided, I saw friends who came into the hospital one day and were gone the next, and they never saw it coming. And I thought, I don't have any time to waste doing things that don't really matter. I want to do the things that matter most. And what I decided I wanted to do was become a comic book artist. So, got together with my family, and this was my heritage. My mother painted. My uncles were painters and printers. My aunt was a graphic designer. That's how I learned my illustration skills, was basically family dinners. And so I got together with my aunt and my uncles and my mother. How are we doing on time? Okay. Why don't you go ahead and flip it over, and I'll just, that'd be awesome. Okay, just making sure we're all right on time. So they put together a portfolio with me, and we sent it to DC Comics, to the senior editor, with a cover letter that said, just wanted to introduce myself. I am your next big discovery in comics, and I'm ready to start working right now. And I'd really like to start on Justice League, but if you have to start me out slow on something like Batman, that's okay too. He sent back a letter and said, all right, you've got some skills, but you're a little too young. I wanna actually see you fix a few of these problems with your work. And then maybe when you're older. And I said, well, tell me the problems and I'll improve those things and you can hire me right now. And if I have to start on Green Lantern, that's good too. Just tell me how to improve and we can get this going. And so a few of those editors, and I wrote to more than one. A couple of them ignored me, a couple corresponded with me, a couple gave me actual pointers about how to improve, but they all said, you're too young, and I didn't think that should matter. So I kept sending work out, kept getting rejections, and then I came across a magazine-sized black and white fantasy comic book called ElfQuest. Now, ElfQuest was written and drawn by Wendy and Richard Pini, who were adults, professionals, and they couldn't sell that book to any of the publishers, so they started their own company. And they were selling 80,000 copies an issue of ElfQuest. Then they colored the first 5 issues and put it out as one of the first true graphic novels in the American market, and they sold 1 million books. And I thought, I want to do that. I talked my aunt to taking me to the World Science Fiction Convention in Anaheim that year, because they just wrapped up the original 20 issues of ElfQuest and they were having an end of the quest party, and I wanted to attend. So my aunt took me to this thing where I walked around this party sweating blood for 2 hours before I finally went and approached Wendy and Richard, and I showed them my portfolio. And they said, this looks really good. You've got a lot of promise, but we're not publishing any new books right now. And I said, I don't want you to publish my book. And they said, well, we're not hiring any artists or investing in anything. I said, I don't want you to do that either. They said, then why did you come all this way to show us your portfolio? And I said, I wanted to do this so that I could tell you to your faces, you inspired me, and I'm going to do what you did, and I'm going to start my own company to publish my own work, and I'm going to come back here next year as one of your peers, and I wanted you to already know who I was. And they said, that's awesome. And I'm just going to jump ahead on something in the timeline here so that you know, so I don't forget to say it later. I have a big slipcase, hardcover, full-color, 35-year career art retrospective that we did through a Kickstarter that I'm finishing the layout work as soon as I get home from this conference. And the afterword to that book is going to be by Wendy and Richard Pini, and it begins with the words, and that's what he did. All of your choices are cumulative. So I went back home, got together with my best friend, and said, so we need to figure out how to start this comic book company. And I said, well, we spend a lot of money on comics, but if we got a wholesale account, we'd get 50% discount. We can save the 50% we're not spending on comics, and that can be our war chest. So I talked a distributor in Colorado into giving us a retailer wholesale account. They needed to see a business card. Called my aunt and uncle, we had a business card. Then they said, well, I want to see a photo of your storefront. So we painted a sign in my mother's barnyard and convinced our neighbors that had an old grocery store to let us hang it in front of the grocery store for a photo so I can get that wholesale account. So we started saving that money, 50% on everything we were buying, and we were building up to it. And we knew we could publish the book, but then we said, how are we going to market it? How are we going to sell these? How are we going to tell people about it? And I said, well, we need to be exhibitors at the San Diego Comic-Con, largest comic convention in the country. And he said, how are we going to afford to do that? And I said, easy. We're going to go down to the bank and get a bank loan. So we got on our bikes and rode down to the bank and pitched them about a bank loan based on our little mail order business. And he said, well, you're not making that much money with this mail order you're doing. I don't think we can give you this loan. I'm sorry. I said, it's okay. We understand. And we tried the next bank and the next bank and the next bank. Tried every bank in the state of Arizona. And at the time, it was about 36. And they all said no. Even tried a bank in New Mexico, because I talked my mother into taking us on a picnic at the Petrified Forest. Then I distracted her. She missed the turnoff, and we ended up in New Mexico. She says, we are in another state. How did this happen? I said, I don't know, Mom, but why don't I go over to that bank and ask for directions? She said, I knew you wore your good shirt for a reason. The New Mexico bank said no. In the meantime, the first bank had gotten a new bank manager, and I told my buddy, he's fresh meat. He doesn't know us yet, and I have practiced this 40 times. So we went one more time and made this other pitch to this new bank manager, who looked at us, listened to us, and then just sat there. And we sat there smiling at him, and he smiled at us, and finally says, you know, I like you boys. I like what I hear in your voice when you talk. I like what I see in your face. I'm going to give you this loan. And he walked out of his office and came back in with an envelope full of cash and a piece of paper that said, I promise to repay this loan, and it had a line for a signature. I got another loan a year later. There was a whole lot more paperwork involved. That was not how loans worked. And it took a while for us to realize it wasn't a bank loan. It was a loan from the bank manager because he believed in us and he wanted to see this happen. So we got a booth at San Diego. We got a hotel. We got a U-Haul truck to take all these comic books we were having printed. This was the comic book that I did, magazine size like ElfQuest. We had 10,000 of them in a rental truck. We had to hire my aunt to drive us because neither one of us had a driver's license yet. But we were publishing professionals. The work was good enough to sell, and we knew how to meet with the distributors at this convention so we could sell those books. Now, in those days, everything was 10-foot table. You had a 10-foot booth with your t-shirts and comics and posters. They weren't doing all the huge exhibits like we do nowadays. And all that mattered was what was on that table had quality and was worth paying for. it did not matter that I was not a huge corporation in New York publishing books for 50 years. It mattered we had something cool. And it didn't matter how old we were. Now, I had sold enough comics to pay for the things we needed to pay, but I was still learning. I was still on a learning path. Second issue was only ever published in the trade journal, The Comics Buyer's Guide. That is the rarest James Owen item out there. Because I was getting better with every page, and I didn't want to put out anything less than my best work. But that also turned into a business doing design work for some of the Hollywood studios. I had an assistant who was 25 who worked in my office in my bedroom while I was at school. And he would tell people, well, Mr. Owen's in some meetings right now. When he gets back in, he can call you and we'll work on those projects. So I built up a resume before I was out of high school. Got out of high school, was still doing design work. Moved to the Phoenix area, got married, and still felt like I have missed something. Somehow I missed that path to my great destiny. Then an opportunity came up that I thought I couldn't pass up. It was a job opening as a storyboard artist at the Sullivan Bluth Animation Studio. And I said, you know, that I would love to do. I love their films, All Dogs Go to Heaven, An American Tale, Land Before Time. I would love to work with them, be part of a team. Maybe that's my destiny. And my friend who told me about the job said, well, one hitch, you have to move to Ireland because that's where the studio is. And we had to decide, how is this going to work? And decided this, if we're going to try this, let's try it. So we had a yard sale, sold all the stuff we had, extra clothes, pots and pans, everything except my book collection, my drafting table my mother gave me, and my wife's sewing machine and hope chest, and our dog. Everything else got sold so I could get a plane ticket to Ireland. And I went to Ireland with a briefcase, a suitcase, and a portfolio. And when I got there, I got to the studio, which is next to the River Liffey by Phoenix Park, largest urban park in the world. And I sat there on a park bench thinking, this is perfect. I'm going to go down that hill to that job, doing the work I'm able to do that I love with people who inspire me. This is my destiny. So I went down to the studio and told them who I was and what job I was there for. And he said, wow, who told you about the job? And I told him, I said, oh, you had an inside track because we're not advertising that. But come on, you're perfect for it. We're going to show you around the studio. And we walked around, and I just got happier and happier as the day went on. And finally said, we've got some paperwork to take care of. We're going to put you in this waiting room. Just wait here. Somebody will come for you. And they left me there for 6 hours. And finally, when the door did open, they said, are you James Owen? And I said, yes, I am. And he said, come with me. There's a meeting. You should be there. And we went to a room that had a few hundred people in it and a guy at the front with a microphone who announced that they just lost their bank financing for the next 5 projects and they were going to have to let go of 3/4 of the staff and the ones they were keeping was based entirely on seniority. I had been there for 6 hours. So after the meeting, I went back up to my supervisor and I said, well, I just got here. What does this mean for me? And he says, James, it's nothing but good news for you. Because we all have paperwork and red tape to deal with, but you're free to go. So it was a pleasure to meet you. Thank you so much for coming. Good luck with your career. Goodbye. And I walked back up the hill to that bench in Phoenix Park, and I stuck my hand in my pocket. And this coin, £1, was all the money I had left in the world. And that was it, and that was all. And I realized, how did this happen to me? 7 hours ago, this was my great destiny. Now I am broke in Ireland. I can't pay for the place I'm staying at. How did this happen? And then I realized it happened because I made it happen. And I had another opportunity to make something happen, to decide to live deliberately. So I made my decision. Went down, found a payphone, called my wife, collect, and said, good news and bad news. The bad news is we're not moving to Ireland. Good news is I'm starting a new comic book company and doing what I should have been doing all along and publishing my own work. I don't need another company. I don't need to have a job writing and drawing someone else's stories. I need to be doing mine. And I already know how to do it because I did it when I was a teenager. And I'll explain later, but I've got to go let some other people know. And I went, and all these other artists who had been let go from their jobs, a little bit upset, and they saw me smiling and said, James, what are you smiling about? And I said, didn't you hear the great news? I just started a comic book company. And the thing is when people hear you making choices like that, they find ways to help you. And somebody that I'd never met who was in Galway on the other side of Ireland said, that's the bravest decision I've ever heard. I know what he's doing. And that was pretty brave. And he called the bed and breakfast where I was staying and says, let James Owen stay as long as he needs to stay. Feed him whatever he needs to eat. And when he has to leave, I'm going to come settle his bill. So I had a place to stay and plan. Turned out the plane ticket we got was a round trip special. I never planned on using the return ticket, so now I had a ticket home the next week. And I came back to Arizona where we had an apartment. We got into an apartment where we had a sewing machine, a hope chest, a drafting table, comic books, and a dog. My wife got a job selling floor coverings, and with her first paycheck, we paid the bills and then bought some paper, pens, and pencils. And I started writing and drawing what became the first issue of my comic book series, Star Child. Now, Star Child, like the earlier comic books, it's the same mind making those choices. And all we had to do was sell 1,000 copies to be able to pay the printing bill. And we could build from there. First issue came out, and we got orders for 1,200 copies. So printing bill, pizza money. We had the priorities covered. Second issue, we got the orders in, not so good. They had ordered 600 copies. So we can't even pay the printing bill, which means I can't go on to issue number 3, which means my career is over before it's begun. But then something else happened, another one of those choices I was talking about. The week after issue number 2 of Star Child shipped, I crushed my drawing hand in a car accident. And everyone in the world said, he had promise, but it's over now. There was even a gentle intervention with the doctors, because this was a pretty bad accident. A young lady turned left in front of me, I plowed into her. My hand had been on the gear shift, and it hit the radio, mashed up my hand in the radio, which was sad because I had only just figured out how to program the radio. And in this gentle intervention, they said, we know you're feeling optimistic about this, but you need to accept reality. The doctors have said there is too much damage, and even with therapy, you're not going to get 100% back. And I thought about this. And then I realized something significant, that no matter how much they care for us, the people around us are never going to be able to completely understand our perspective, which is our unique mix of hopes and dreams and memories and ambitions and desires. And I believe that's unique enough that every once in a while, the universe opens itself up to you and you alone and shows you something that's possible. And you have to decide in that moment how much you believe in what you see, even if it means telling everyone else in the world they're wrong. I very diplomatically said, thank you for your concern. You're all wrong. This is what I'm going to do. And I came up with what I called the secret of art. Made a couple of choices here. Secret of art, very simple, very zen. It's making lines on paper and choosing where they go. Now, I couldn't make the lines with this hand, but I had another hand that could make lines. And I could choose here. So I created a prequel issue called Starchild Number 0, where each page was a half page of typeset text and a half page illustration I laid out with my left hand. And then I got other comic artists to ink those pages because I had met them when I was 16 years old as an exhibitor at the San Diego Comic-Con. And we got some of the best comic book artists in the world, including Mr. Will Eisner, that our industry awards are named for. The novelist Alan Dean Foster wrote an introduction. We put it in the catalogs. My wife lost her job. Now we really needed to sell some books. And we were hoping to sell 3,000. Pay the old bill, pay the new bill, move forward with issue number 3. While this was happening, I told my therapist, I don't need 100% of use of my hand. I need 100% of a very specific thing. I have to be able to hold a pen and a pencil. So he said, all right. So for 4 hours a day for the next 8 months, I put screws into blocks of wood with my thumb and fingers to build those muscles so I could hold a pen. We put starch aisle number zero in the catalogs. And remember the thing I started this talk with. If you really want to do something, no one can stop you. If you really don't want to do something, no one can help you. But the choice has to be yours. And we sold 45,000 copies of that comic book. It became the best-selling independent comic book of the season. I got to meet several other small self-publishers. We banded together to do a trade show tour and went on to do another 24 issues, sold 250,000 comic books, hardcovers, paperbacks, limited editions, and it launched my career. Now, I'm keeping an eye on our time, so I'm gonna fast forward a little bit through this next part, because what that did, Starchild established my career. That got me the attention of a famous novelist in Germany who hired me to write a book in a series he was designing called Mythworld. That first Mythworld book won an international fiction award. I also got the contract to write the other six, so Mythworld was now my series there. That gave me the experience to write and illustrate Here There Be Dragons. But there was a gap before Here There Be Dragons happened. In thinking about what had happened with that accident, I didn't want that to happen again. So I started a magazine company, Argosy for fiction, International Studio for art. And I thought, if I'm doing something that I don't have to do every page myself, then we've got a buffer in case, you know, something disastrous happens. Well, those magazines sold really well, won a lot of awards, then the distributor went bankrupt, owing me about 400 grand. And Jeff Vandermeer called me up and he says, James, five magazines have gone out of business in the last month because of these guys. I know you signed for all this stuff personally. You're in trouble. What are you gonna do? And I said, brother, thought about that, and I have a plan. I need to write and sell a best-selling novel and then get a movie deal for a gazillion dollars. And when that happens, I can pay off all these debts and move forward, and everything's great, so don't worry, man, I've got this. And Jeff goes, God be with you, James. And I loaded up my van with a bunch of books and comic books and art and stories and headed for Los Angeles. I had a manager, I had an entertainment attorney. I was sure I was gonna get that deal, and nothing happened. Many, many weeks of nothing happened. Till finally, we got a phone call from a guy that was a publisher, and he called my brother at the studio and said, have those Mythworld books ever been published over here in English? And my brother said no, and he said, I'd love to talk to James about them. And so the guy called me up, and we chatted about this, and he said, you know, I originally wanted Mythworld, but I heard you've got this outline floating around Hollywood called Here There Be Dragons. Now that we could sell. And I know you're in trouble. So if you say yes to a publishing deal to do that book, I will wire you the advance tomorrow. That never happens. This was a, wow, he's gonna come in and save me. And I said, well, how much is the advance? And he said, I'm gonna send you $5,000. I needed a whole lot more than that, but nobody else had even taken my calls or a meeting. And I thought, you know what? I can pay the bills, I can pay the mortgage, I can pay my employees, I can get a hamburger, and we'll make it up with the film deal. So I told him yes. I borrowed some money, got in my van, called everybody at home, said, get everyone together. After all this time, I got a book deal. It's gonna work. Everything's gonna work. In the course of this drive home, the publisher called me back and he said, James, I'm so happy that we're doing this and it's gonna be such a gorgeous paperback book. And I said, actually, it's gotta be a hardcover. In Germany, the Mythworld book came out in hardcover, didn't get a lot of money for them, sold the paperback rights for a lot of money. Same way Stephen King did with Carrie. $4,000 for the hardcover, he got $400,000 for the paperback of Carrie. And I said, you can't really go backwards, so it's gotta be a hardcover. And he said, James, I don't think we can sell more than 5,000 of them, which is a great number. But you're a great guy, so I'm gonna send you $6,000. And I said, you're a great guy, and I'll take 4,000 if you'll do it in hardcover. And we argued about this all the way to Blythe, which is a terrible place to be deciding your future. And finally, he was at $9,500 if I would just say yes. I was down at $2,500 if he would just do it in hardcover. And then I made one of the hardest decisions I've ever made in my life. And I told him no. And I've had people ask me, did you reconsider after you said that? And I said, I redialed his number 1,000 times, just never let it go through. I thought that was the right decision. But I still had my friends and family all gathered at home waiting for this wonderful news. And when I got home, I had to tell them what had happened. And what they said was, okay, we believe you, and we're here to help. Just tell us what you need us to do. And I said, I just need to figure out how to take care of all these things and then go back and get the right deal. And just then, another friend of mine ran an oil company and raised racehorses. He shows up and he says, hey, I'm here to celebrate. Tell me what's going on. And I said, you better sit down. And we explained to him what had been going on. And he said, well, why don't you get back there and get the right deal? And I said, as soon as I can figure it out, we will. And he says, how much did you turn down? And I told him. And he sat down and wrote me out a check for $9,600 and said, you go take care of things because we believe in you and we're not going to let you fall. His father was the banker who gave me that bank loan when I was 15 years old. All your choices are cumulative. Now, we are just about out of time, and so I'm going to rush through this last part, which I can, because I've done this a bunch. I told you the story about the accident in my hand. People look at those covers that I do, and they go, there's a million tiny lines in those covers. I can never draw something like that. And I said, everybody in this room can draw that dragon, because it starts with 4 lines. And if somebody who's drawn them before can show you where those 4 lines go, anybody can do that, because it's choices. It's making lines and it's making choices. And that's our metaphor for how we live our lives and how we are building our careers. And so I'm going to jump into this and start drawing a dragon for you that when we walk out of this room, I will have finished, that I started with 4 lines that any of you can do. Okay, 4 lines. Let me add just a few more. Now it's just enough lines, you can see where I'm going with it. I'm going to go ahead and jump into this and finish. While I'm finishing this drawing, I want you to think about what I've shared with you today. Those points I wanted you to remember. All your choices are cumulative, and the sooner you start making good choices about what you want to do, the better your lives will be. Remember, if you really want to do something, no one can stop you. If you really don't want to do something, no one can help you. But the choice is up to you. And if you can make that brave choice to do the thing you believe in, people see it in your face, they hear it in your voice, they will find ways to help you. Remember to live deliberately, to be the one who chooses to act and let the events swirl around you instead of you responding to what's happening. But most of all, never sacrifice what you want the most for what you want the most at that moment. Because what I ended up with going back to LA was an offer from Simon & Schuster that was a preemptive bid. They were willing to outbid everyone up front to get that book. And the first printing was 100,000 copies in hardcover. Here There Be Dragons has been selling in hardcover now for 17 years in 22 languages. The first film option was with the producer of Harry Potter, David Heyman. The second project I was working on there is with the producers of Lord of the Rings. I got paid 20 times what I had turned down just for that first book. And that book and the 7 sequels have established everything about my career. And the last thing I want to leave you with as I finish this drawing are these thoughts. The default state of the world is fear. Your destiny is to be brave. The default state of the world is mediocrity. Your destiny is excellence if you choose it. The default state of the world is what you decide it to be. And if you decide, sooner or later, even if people don't believe in what you're doing, they will have seen you've made enough of the right choices and enough of the right lines that you can step back from all your work and people can see you were drawing a dragon all along. And that is all I have to share with you, except to say thank you for being such a great audience today.